Good afternoon. I think we have some travel issues. I just heard there was a road closed nearby, and so we probably will have a slow trickle of people coming in and joining us this afternoon. But I do want to welcome those of you here and online to our event this afternoon. I'm like a kid in a candy store today, so excited to talk about these important issues surrounding the U.S. drone program with our distinguished guests. My name is Rachel Stoll. I'm a senior associate here at the Stimson Center. I am the director of the center's Conventional Defense Project, where we examine a range of issues related to conventional weapons and drones and U.S. policy surrounding the use of different kinds of conventional systems around the world. As some of you may know, Stimson's been examining U.S. drone policy for over 3 years. Many of you might have joined our previous events. We had the Stimson Task Force on U.S. drone policy in 2014 that was chaired by General John Abizade and Rosa Brooks, which provided 8 policy recommendations for the Obama administration to undertake on U.S. drone policy. We followed that up in 2016, that was just this year, February 2016, with a report card grading the administration's progress. Did not give them very good grades, and we're hoping that in the final months of the administration, we would see some significant changes to the program surrounding transparency and accountability. There's been a lot of public discourse, not only here at Stimson, but around the country and around the world on the U.S. drone program, and particularly with regards to the legal basis for the U.S. Drone program, and I'm delighted that we're going to focus on that a little bit today. So I want to thank you all for joining us in what's sure to be a really insightful conversation on the efforts to reveal key components about the U.S. drone program and other issues that are going to not only confront the waning days of the Obama administration, but certainly the new Trump administration when it takes office next year. So I'm very pleased to welcome Jameel Jaffer and Charlie Savage, and really grateful that they've chosen to spend their afternoon with us to talk about their work on these issues. There are detailed bio sheets available for each of them, but let me just offer some brief words of introductions for those online who don't have the sheet in front of them. Jameel serves as the founding director of the Knight First Amendment Institute at Columbia University. But he's going to talk mostly about his role as the former deputy legal director of the ACLU, where he oversaw the ACLU's work relating to national security for almost a decade and litigated some of the most significant cases relating to U.S. counterterrorism policy after 9/11. Charlie, to my left, is a Washington correspondent for the New York Times and a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist. He's been covering post-9/11 issues, including national security, individual rights, and the rule of law for over a decade, and has been with The Times since 2008. And what's interesting about bringing both of them together is the ACLU and the New York Times have been at the forefront of efforts to get the administration to disclose information that could contribute to greater accountability of the U.S. drone program, as well as to inform a more robust public debate about the use of drones that will also engender, I think, greater understanding of the strategic and political aims of the U.S. drone program, and then allow us to assess the program's efficacy. Jameel joins us today on the heels of the launch of his new book, The Drone Memos, which is, if you didn't see it on your way in, don't worry, there'll be a chance to purchase it as you leave, or stay for the reception, and even get an autograph from Jameel, if you so desire. But this book traces efforts to shine more light on the U.S. use of armed drones for targeted killings and serves as a compendium of official documents that offer a glimpse of the legal and policy frameworks that underpin the program. It's a really insightful 55-page introduction to a variety of documents that the U.S. has released over the past several years. Charlie is joining us to offer his perspectives on the internal deliberations and processes that have shaped U.S. counterterrorism policy and the U.S. drone program that was captured in his book, Power Wars, also available outside. It is a very comprehensive look at a series of incidents, the bureaucratic processes that have sort of gotten us to where we are today. Now, I could spend the next 3 hours speaking to Jameel and Charlie on my own, but I think it's probably more interesting for you if we have this as more of a conversation. And so what I'd like to do, instead of if you've come to some of our events on this topic in the past, you'll know that we give presentations and then we open it up to the audience. What I'd like to do today is really feature this entire event as a conversation. And so I'm going to enjoy the moderator's prerogative of asking Jameel and Charlie questions, and then I promise I will open them to you, but hopefully my questions will spur some thinking of your own as well. So I want to start with Jameel, since you have this brand new book that is a really great read, and it's a dense read in the sense of it has a lot of legalese and explanation, but it also tells a very interesting story. So I want to know, why did you put this book together? What were you hoping to accomplish? There's a lot of books about drones out
there.
There
are a few different things. One is the documents that are in the book got released over a period of 5 years or so, or 6 years, and there's speeches in the book two, which were given by administration officials over a period of about 6 years. And every time there was a release of information, there was a public debate about that incremental release. But I felt increasingly like we weren't looking at the implications of the whole thing. And I thought it might be useful to kind of step back and think about what all of this meant together, and also about the evolution of the policies over time. So that was part of it. I also felt like I was frustrated by these lawsuits that we filed that were, you know, largely unsuccessful. These lawsuits challenging a couple strikes that killed three American citizens in Yemen, and the courts essentially said, these are questions for the political branches to decide. We have no role to play in saying who's the lawful target. We have no role to play in saying what body of law governs in these circumstances. And I thought those were really indefensible decisions. I still do. I think that those are really awful decisions, and that, you know, 20, 30, or maybe even 3 years from now, we'll look back on those decisions and realize how awful they were. But we didn't appeal those decisions, and I still had a litigator's energy, and I wanted to make the case that those decisions, you know, should be thought of as at the very least wrong, and so this was an effort to make that case. I guess, you know, I also had in my head, as I think a lot of human rights advocates did over the last 8 years, that we were investing a lot of power in President Obama because, you know, collectively we trusted President Obama. You know, he was somebody who was steeped in constitutional law. He was surrounded by people who were civil libertarians and human rights advocates themselves, and so people trusted him. And we were willing to give him these sweeping powers that we never would have given President Bush had he tried to expand the drone campaign in 2008 in the way that President Obama did, you know, over the next 3 years. I don't think that we would have let him do it. I think the courts would have said no. I think even Congress might have said no. Certainly Americans, there would have been real concern and maybe even outrage across the political spectrum. Because at that point in 2008, a lot of President Bush's national security policies were looked at, you know, at the very least, you know, very skeptically by Americans across the political spectrum. There was consensus, maybe too strong a word, but something approaching consensus about closing Guantanamo. The torture policies were looked at as an embarrassment at the very least, and by many as a scandal. The Supreme Court had rejected President Bush's national security policies on several different occasions. I just don't think we would have invested these kinds of powers in President Bush, but President Obama comes along and we were willing to do it. And you know, a lot of human rights advocates said over the last 8 years, you know, we're giving all this power to President Obama because we trust President Obama, but who knows who the next person will be? And you know, I wanted, like everybody else, I wanted to say that once more. You know, and I take no pleasure in the fact that that I've been vindicated, or that argument turns out to have been the right one. But I do think that it was a mistake to invest these powers in the presidency, because you don't know who's going to hold that office, you know, 4 years from now or 8 years from now.
Do you think that's the main message of the introduction? For those that haven't read it yet, there's this 55-page introduction that sort of lays out the process that got us to the limited transparency that we still have, because I think that's sort of the end result, is we know more than we did before, but not really in a way that's comprehensive or as useful as we would like. I think the disappointment comes through in your introduction. Is the main message that, is it that we didn't get this right and we need to fix it, or is there a different message that you were hoping to accomplish?
You know, when I started writing it, it seemed like a much more positive exercise in a way, because I was arguing that, you know, I felt like these are things I need to say in order to convince somebody that we need to change the, you know, impose clearer and stricter limits on some of these policies, be more transparent about the use of these powers. But it seemed like a more positive argument, because I thought that there was some real possibility that somebody would listen. Now, to be honest, it feels like a much more despairing book. Because I don't get the impression that the Trump administration is going to have patience for these kinds of proposals. And to the contrary, I worry that the Trump administration will be eager to exploit the powers that President Obama claimed, and may even have used, you know, that President Obama may even have used, relatively speaking, you know, relatively wisely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I worry that the next administration might use those powers much more aggressively.
And I wonder, as I was reading it, I was wondering, is this about, because it's got all these documents, it has all the speeches, so transparency is really front and center
mm-hmm.
in the book. But I'm wondering if your principal complaint, and maybe it's actually multiple complaints, maybe it's not just one, is about the rules governing the U.S. drone program, is it about the process, or is it about sort of the lack of transparency itself? Or maybe it's a combo.
Yeah, I think it's all of the above. You know, so the drone campaign is based in part on this theory that the law of war provides the relevant framework for assessing the lawfulness of any of these strikes, no matter where they're carried out, whether it's Somalia or Yemen or Libya or Iraq or Syria. The administration's position is that as a legal matter, it's international humanitarian law, the law of war, that provides the right reference point. Now, the administration has imposed these, or has adopted these policy constraints as a matter of executive discretion for strikes carried out away from zones of actual hostilities. But those are policy, you know, policy constraints that could be rescinded or dispensed with by the next administration. So there my complaint is a substantive one. I think that is not the right body of rules. I think that if you're carrying out strikes away from, in places where the administration, that the administration describes as away from zones of actual hostilities, it's international human rights law that should apply, and not the law of armed conflict. And international human rights law is much more restrictive than the law of armed conflict. So that's my substantive complaint. The process complaint, it's largely about, you know, it doesn't matter what the right, so put aside for a second the question of what the right substantive standard is. You still have a question of who decides whether that substantive standard has been met. And there, too, I think that the administration's arguments are wrong. I mean, I think with respect to strikes carried out away from conventional battlefields, I think that the administration should have to account for its actions to some independent decision maker. You know, we brought these cases on behalf of U.S. citizens because there the issue was presented, I think, most sharply. U.S. citizens whose survivors were arguing that the government should be required to explain and account for mm-hmm. the killing of their relatives. And in one case, it was this 16-year-old boy, the son of Anwar al-Awlaki, who had been targeted, but the 16-year-old boy who was killed in Yemen in 2011. And we made the argument that maybe this is justified under international law. Maybe the government has a sufficient justification for this strike that ended up killing the 16-year-old American. But it should have to present that to somebody other than itself, that it should have to go to a judge and say, here's why we did what we did. Mm-hmm. So that's a kind of process complaint. And the transparency one we've already talked about a little bit, but now I think there's a lot more transparency about these policies than there was at the beginning, in part because of the litigation that the ACLU did and the New York Times did. Also in part because the administration decided over time to release information that it had previously withheld, as a matter of discretion. But even now, there's information about civilian casualties that the administration is not releasing. The information we have is at the level of aggregate statistics, not broken down by country or by time period. So there's information like that that's still being withheld, and there's still Justice Department legal memos that relate to the targeted killing program that are still being withheld. So I don't think that we're done on transparency, and the ACLU is still litigating some of those cases, and I'm glad that they are, because I think there's still more to be released.
Well, I think transparency is a good segue to Charlie, because I think that one of the challenges that those of us who are either human rights advocates or work in think tanks and are trying to get information out is we come up against a lack of information. And so I'm wondering, in your work, which relies on information, and then you're also sharing information, what have the obstacles with regards to the transparency been in order for you to write some of the news articles that you've put out on this very subject?
Sure. So let me just say at the onset that this is going to be a slightly asymmetrical conversation, just to be clear, because of the role I play and the role that Jameel plays. Jameel is in a position to, and in fact should be, making normative arguments to advance his point of view, and I need to be more in the sort of explanatory mode. My role is to seek out, bring to the light, understand, explain. And that means I have a normative view about transparency, which is there ought to be more of it. But beyond that, I'm a sort of agnostic. I have spent some years here trying to surface more information and try to bring certain clarity to these discussions of what the powers are the government is taking unto itself, what the procedures are when they're using this new technology for the purpose of killing people. What the substantive standards are that are being met, and what's actually happening behind the scenes, because the government, especially earlier in this administration, was quite secretive about it. And I want to make actually a couple points in that area, and then I'll talk about efforts to bring this more to light. So just in terms of clarifying kind of what we're talking about, one sort of takeaway point that I like to impress upon audiences is that there's a fallacy in how we talk about this that in some ways is reflected in Jameel's title, which is that this is about drones. And because it happens a lot with drones now that drones exist. But it's important to realize that drones are merely a means of killing. And sometimes killing is legal and sometimes killing is not legal, but with very few exceptions, the means by which you kill are irrelevant to the legal question. Right, so there's a few exceptions where the weapons themselves are banned, chemical weapons, weapons of mass destruction. But the fact that there's not a pilot sitting in this aircraft does not change the equation of evaluating whether a particular airstrike was legal or not. So we're talking about killing, which can be legal or not legal. Jameel earlier was talking about whether the law of war or human rights law should apply to these situations. And so another takeaway that I like to impress on audiences is that you often hear the critique from the left of this administration or the Bush administration before it of waging a global war on terror of having a borderless war, in the sense that the war is everywhere, the world is a battlefield. And that's not really a precise way of talking about what's at stake and what's in play here. There was at the beginning after 9/11 a critique among the left and in Europe in particular that the United States proclamation that it was at war with Al-Qaeda was wrong as a legal matter, that a government could not be at war with a non-state actor that sort of flowed across different national boundaries, and that this was, you know, Al-Qaeda was like a band of pirates or something, and that this was a criminal matter, and that the Bush administration was wrong to use this invocation of wartime powers. And what does that really mean when we talk about wartime powers versus human rights law? What that boils down to, especially when you're talking about airstrikes, is when you can pull the trigger. Because even in a human rights law context, you can still kill people without trial, right? As a matter of self-defense. If someone is posing an imminent threat to you, you can kill them, just like a cop can shoot someone who's about to shoot the cop or shoot an innocent person. But in war, imminence doesn't matter. In war, on a battlefield, if your enemy is across the field there, even if he's not looking at you, even if he's asleep in the barracks, you can kill him at any time, just based on his status as part of the enemy. And so when you're talking about airstrikes, where there's no feasibility of capture, because you don't have troops on the ground, what this argument really boils down to is whether a terrorism suspect, has to be in the act of, you know, pushing the button that will launch the strike, and that's when you can fire the missile at him, or when you see him and you have a fleeting opportunity to take him out, whether it's lawful to do it at any time, assuming there's not civilians around and so forth. The Bush and now Obama administration have expanded the notion of a battlefield in a way that is controversial but falls short, actually, of the sort of caricature that it's a borderless war that encompasses the entire world. What we're really talking about are a handful of failed or failing states in the sort of North Africa, Middle East region, where there are vast swaths of territory that there is no effective government control over. So that when the terrorist who is supposedly plotting something is located, there is no police force that can be sent in to arrest him and suppress the threat that he may pose in the sort of a less than lethal means. And we do not have troops on the ground that can go capture him. But we do have an aircraft overhead with or without a pilot. Is it lawful to take the strike in that circumstance? In a situation where there is no trial, but we don't have trials in absentia in our legal system. And so what do you do? That's the dilemma posed by this. So we're talking about Somalia, Yemen, tribal Pakistan, in parts of Libya now, but we're not talking about the world, because most of the world, Paris, South Africa, Japan, whatever, has a normal government that exercises control and has a police force that can suppress the threat. So that's another takeaway. Whether or not imminence matters in this situation where a wartime enemy, according to the US government, has flowed into a space where there is no government, can you take the shot or not when you locate that person? So these are, it took me a while to sort of lay that out. Right? These are sort of subtle, complicated things, and understanding how this government, as its sort of its power to take these shots has grown because drone technology has given it the opportunity to do something at a practical level that was less frequently available before this technology existed, which doesn't change the legal calculus. Understanding how the government is thinking about the powers, the precedents it's setting, seems to me, is an extraordinarily important part of where this country and this world is going in the post 9/11 world that we continue to live in. And part of my journalism has been to try to understand it, and that has been to try to get people to talk to me about it, or to release documents for the public to read, in a situation where everything is presumptively classified and subject to attorney-client privilege on top of that. And it's quite difficult, right? You're sort of seeing everything through a glass darkly. And so I've tried to get people to explain it, and maybe who think that the government should be more forthcoming than the official policy is to be. And we have brought Freedom of Information Act litigation often in parallel with the ACLU, seeking court orders to try to get documents out. But it's been exceedingly slow going, and as Jameel said, most of those cases tend to fail.
And I wonder if you could, I mean, there was a lot in there that I would love to sort of unpack, but just
yes.
to follow up on your last point, can you talk a little bit about the suits that you filed? I think that's really, and I thought out from Jameel's book as well, just the sort of the mundaneness of, you know, we're not asking for every single document that's ever been written that has the word drone in it, or
well, they are. That's been their strategy.
But even in the case, even in the cases that you reference in the introduction, it's very much related to, as you said, on behalf of these U.S. citizens to understand, so that you can understand
yeah.
more the process and have recourse, et cetera. Can you talk a little bit about the process, the cases themselves, and what that litigation would have helped you
sure.
accomplish?
Well, so I mean, first things first, the ACLU has been the primary player in this area. And so by talking about our case that was in parallel to them, I don't want people to misunderstand that somehow these are equal. They, you know, they've been done the most work and gotten the most documents out. And part of the reason for that is that their litigation strategy has been to ask for everything. And our litigation strategy has been to ask for targeted things.
Right.
Right, so sort of.
I'll let you finish your answer, but I want to respond to that.
Oh, okay. No, but as a result, they tend to, you know, be in court a lot longer. But when things do succeed, they get all kinds
get
of
good
stuff.
Stuff. Yeah.
And we kind of like get our document and go home. So the most famous case that we were both involved in this area involved the Justice Department memos that signed off on the killing of Anwar Aliki, the American-born radical Muslim cleric who the U.S. said was an operational terrorist with Al-Qaeda's Yemen branch and partially behind the attempt to blow up a plane flying into Detroit on Christmas in 2009 and several other plots, as well as putting out propaganda that even long after his death continues to radicalize English-speaking Muslims. So my colleague Scott Shane, who had written about Aliki and eventually wrote a book about him,
and has been featured here at Stimson mm-hmm. about his book.
So he asked in 2010, he submitted a FOIA request for memos about drone strikes or something like that, targeted killing operations, and had heard nothing back. In 2011, when the fall of 2011, when the strike that killed Aliki happened, I wrote a newspaper article based on just anonymous sources saying there's this memo and here's roughly what people who've read it say is in it and the arguments it makes, the limits it identifies. And then I submitted a FOIA request of my own for that memo, for OLC memos about the killing of Americans specifically. And a couple of weeks later, they finally responded to Scott's year and a half old request and to mine simultaneously and said, you know, we can neither confirm nor deny that there aren't any such memos. And the ACLU around that same time submitted a similar memo, not just for a request, not just for the final memo, but for internal memoranda discussing what would be in the final memos and whatever evidence might have been available that was the basis for the strike that killed Aliki and his son 2 weeks later. And we eventually each filed lawsuits, and because they were so similar, they were consolidated before the same judge, even though it made us slightly uncomfortable because they're an advocacy organization and we're just a news organization. You don't usually want to be aligned like that, but when it comes to transparency, I guess we're advocatory too, right? So that's okay. So we fought this case for years, and the district court judge ruled against us in a sort of famous case with a famous opinion about how she basically thought we were right, but it was like an Alice in Wonderland situation. She could see no way to get us where she thought it should be, and then we eventually got it reversed at the Second Circuit level in a rare victory. But the reason we won was because in the interim, a white paper, a sort of unsigned, unclassified essay that summarized some of these legal arguments that had been prepared but never publicly released by the government, was leaked to NBC News. And my colleague Scott Shane again and another reporter named Jason Leopold had both FOIA'd for that document as well. And once it was leaked unofficially to NBC, an official at the Justice Department was like, oh, sure, you can have it and gave them sort of a clean copy, because NBC had very stupidly stamped their corporate logo all over the document because they wanted to dance in the end zone about having been leaked this thing, and you couldn't even read it. And so, like, here's a clean, at least a legible version. But that act of giving a clean version of this memo out was an official act. And so the court ruled that the government at that point had already acknowledged that it had all these legal theories about this that were sort of echoed or mirrored in this memo, and therefore it could no longer claim that its legal arguments about this topic were secret. Therefore, it had to give us the memos, the real ones about killing Alec. And so it was like this strange quirk that by which we finally got to see the real memos in redacted form, and an almost unrepeatable one, because the takeaway for that from the government's perspective is don't write white papers, or if someone leaks them, don't do a nice thing and officially put them out. It wasn't that there was some broader principle that the public had a right to know, which is of course what we on the plaintiff's side were arguing. It was just, well, this isn't secret anymore anyway, in a sort of one-off. And so that was satisfying that we got to see those memos, but it was also kind of a depressing victory when you really thought about it.
Well, I think I'm going to let you respond, but I think the question I would ask you to sort of guide that response is, you know, your book has the speeches, the memos, even in redacted form. There is more transparency today than there was even last year when we sat around a table bemoaning the lack of transparency. Is there ever going to be enough transparency? Is there a point where we say, okay, we have enough and we don't need to see everything? Or do we really need to see it all in order to make a larger determination and understanding of the program itself?
So my answer to that is the same thing I was going to say to Charlie, which is it's not accurate or fair to say that the ACLU asked for everything. We didn't ask for everything. We asked for more than you guys did, which created a problem for us, because we were largely in alignment in the district court because we didn't have anything at that point, and we were all arguing making the same arguments. But at a certain point, the argument started to focus on the factual information in the memo, in the memo that had authorized the killing of Anwar al-Awlaki. And we ended up getting a lot of the legal analysis from that memo. Both the New York Times and the ACLU got that legal analysis through this Second Circuit opinion that Charlie mentioned. But the factual section in which the government set out the factual basis for the strike, or the factual basis for its conclusion that Anwar al-Awlaki was a lawful target, it was an 11-page section. It was all redacted.
In other words, what the intelligence showed about who he was and what he was doing.
Right. And, there's a sense in which, like, the first reaction people have when I say, well, we wanted the factual information, the first reaction a lot of people have is, well, that's intelligence sources and methods. Of course you're not going to get that. But if the government had charged Anwar al-Awlaki with a crime and had prosecuted him in court, they would have had to introduce a lot of that material at the criminal trial to justify imprisoning him. And if the government is going to carry out these strikes of U.S. citizens, killing U.S. citizens, it's hard to see why we wouldn't want to require the government to introduce some version of the same evidence that it would have had to introduce in a criminal trial. So, we felt strongly that some version of that factual information should be made public. And, the Times, there are a million reasons why people end up requesting information or not requesting information, good reasons, bad reasons, some of them are strategic, some of them are, tactical reasons. I don't fault the Times for not having sought the factual information, but the fact that the Times didn't seek it and we sought it made our request seem, like a kind of, a crazy request of a left-wing advocacy group. And I think, had
just
the effect
to put
of...
Just I mean, we sought the whole memo, which included that 11-page section.
I feel like
you guys were also
second took it all of a sudden.
You guys were also seeking other stuff that would have fed into that 11-page summary, right? It's not like we didn't
No,
want
but I think
pages.
That you guys went away on the remand. Maybe I'm misremembering, but I thought that you guys didn't pursue the factual information, but I could be wrong. There were definitely places where we requested more than the Times, and, you could make a judgment call about, whether... you know, whether a certain category of records should have been litigated over or not. And, you know, at the end of the day, there are going to be disagreements at the margin. The point I want to make is that those disagreements, when there are two different parties in court and one of them is arguing for more and the other one is arguing for less, it sort of undermines, it makes it harder for the party arguing for more to ask for more, because it seems like, just sort of by comparison, you seem unreasonable, by comparison to the other party. And then the question about will we ever have enough? Yes, absolutely. I think that there's stuff that the government can legitimately withhold and should withhold from the public. The stuff that I think that the public has a right to see really falls into maybe three categories: the legal justifications for the program, and I think we have a great deal of that now. The second category would be the factual basis for strikes, at least the ones that killed American citizens. I think that there's a due process argument or a public trial argument of some kind that the public has a right to know why the government is doing that to its own citizens. And then information about civilian casualties. So I think that there's more that ought to be released in each of those categories, but I think we've made a lot of progress on the legal arguments. Less on the factual basis and less on civilian casualties.
You know, one of the things Obama did just a few months ago was put out the official figure of civilian bystander deaths from away from battlefield zones, and which is a range that they don't really know, showing that they don't really know, and was criticized as too low, but at least it was something, and there was something to argue about. But it was also a giant pile of statistics from an 8-year span or 7-year span. And as part of that, he issued an order that the government going forward would put out this information on an annual basis, which would give much more granular detail for what he thought would be, of course, be the Hillary Clinton administration, of what was going on and at least the government's understanding of the mistakes it had made or not. I think that which was sort of like transparency for thee, but not for me, because he wasn't willing to live under that rule himself, even retroactively to do it year by year, so because you don't really know what this number means when it's so many, you can't pull out any individual strike from it. I anticipate, though, that order will be, one of the huge number of things that Donald Trump rescinds early in his administration, so that probably was a futile effort.
Can I just follow up on something else, Charlie? I wanted to ask you about this, the borderless battlefield thing, because I wonder whether you're giving the administration too much credit. I think you are giving the administration too much credit.
Okay.
So I wonder whether you are conflating the question of legal power, the legal power they've claimed, with the way that they're actually using the power they've claimed. So you're obviously right that they're using this power, as far as we know, in seven countries, and they're not carrying out strikes in Paris or Germany or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm.
Compare the Bush administration, which actually picked people up in the United States on the theory that the United States was part of the battlefield. So there's a big difference.
There's a big difference in the use of the power.
Sorry?
In Italy, too,
right. Mm-hmm. But the claim that they've made is broader than those seven countries. The claim they've made is that, as I understand it, is that international humanitarian law, the law of war, is the relevant framework for any operation carried out against Al-Qaeda or its affiliated forces. And I say that because they said it. John Brennan said it in a public speech. The State Department's legal advisor recently said it about a year ago in another public speech. They've built in other protections, other constraints, right? So they have this unwilling and unable constraint. They have the PPG, the presidential policy guidance that President Obama put in place in 2013. But as I understand those things, those are constraints that are imposed by the executive branch on itself and could be swept away by the next administration. The legal claim is that the law of war is the relevant framework. That's why I think people say that the Obama administration has adopted the view that the battlefield is borderless, and not to minimize the distinctions between the Bush administration and the Obama administration, because again, the Bush administration used these powers much more aggressively. But the legal claim is much closer to what the Bush administration, you know, the claim that the Bush administration made, and the claim that the Obama administration is making now are actually, you know, pretty close.
So these issues get pretty esoteric fast, but I think one of the complexities is that the notion that we are at war, for real, literal war with Al-Qaeda, does different jobs in different spaces. And part of it, I think, is they think the authorization for use of military force provides domestic legal authority as a matter of domestic law to go out and handle Al-Qaeda with wartime authority as opposed to criminal law authority. And then that has sort of an overlay in the international law world where there are spaces in which they can just use combat authority and let the bombs fly. But there are also spaces where they can't. And that comes down to, so there's particular zones of armed conflict, right? And then there's these lawless badland spaces, and then there's the rest of the world. And the international law of sovereignty, by which one country does not use force on another country's soil without its consent, is the thing that constrains it from being the world being a battlefield, except in these weird little places where there really is no government, or the government is unwilling or unable, or it's just an open warfare like Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria. That doesn't necessarily mean that from the vantage point of drone strikes or, you know, airstrikes. Then the other things happen, right? We take custody of some guy who was captured by an ally, and we want to interrogate him on a ship or something and not just immediately bring him before a magistrate. And we're obviously doing that under our AUMF authority. Does that mean that that's a battlefield because he was arrested but being treated as a wartime prisoner? You know, I think it slides into what is the question that's being asked on the domestic level and the international level at any given place, and it oversimplifies to say the world is a battlefield because they have these theories.
I'm curious, when you had made the point about this not being borderless, I had written down the word precedent. And I'm wondering that, you know, I think we can sort of objectively say, well, this is in areas that, you know, are failing states or that don't have the governance to be able to arrest or capture. That's an argument that we're making from where we sit.
Mm-hmm.
I could envision other governments using that same justification in places that we wouldn't necessarily define as ungoverned spaces, but for a variety of reasons, they maybe don't recognize that government. And suddenly, you've set a precedent that allows others to make those same arguments in contexts that don't actually fit the framework that we're leading to. So I think that, I don't know if that sort of bridges the two, but I think that's
I agree with that entirely. That's where all this, the stuff that they're playing with,
is
you look at it within the four corners of the situation that they're facing, and it may seem very reasonable, and this is just, you know, it's a dilemma, there's no perfect answer, but we're going to do X. I think very often the precedent that might be put to is not considered fully, or it's just, it's, you know, who knows what will happen in the future, and the future, we're all dead anyway, but right now we need to solve this problem. But in across the range of these issues, that is a very valid critique. And I would add to that the targeted killing operation that killed Osama bin Laden, right? Because that doesn't fit this mold. Osama bin Laden was not in tribal Pakistan where there's no real government. He was in Islamabad, Abbottabad, where there is the normal part of Pakistan, where there is a government and a police force and a security force that could very easily, in theory, have knocked on the door of that compound and arrested him had they been asked to. We, the United States, were afraid that they wouldn't, or that someone within their government would tip him off and he would escape. And so they took this theory that sovereignty can be trumped if a country is unable or unwilling to suppress the threat themselves, and moved it from the easier space of Somalia, rural Yemen, tribal Pakistan, to the much more contentious space of normal Pakistan. And that's a precedent, I think. You know, you can imagine Turkey going to this guy in Pennsylvania that they say was behind the coup and saying, how come you're not extraditing him? You're unable or unwilling to suppress the threat. we can drop a bomb on him under your precedent. And well, why is that wrong? It's hard to exactly, other than just the real politics that the United States is very powerful and people wouldn't mess with us that way if they were smart.
Well,
but that's not law.
It takes me back to the point that you made, and it's a point that I just wrote about, in fact, last week, which is that I think we often get lost in this discussion that we're talking about drones. Mm-hmm. We're talking about a specific platform. And I think the platform is being used to as a tactic of what should be a larger strategy. And what often gets lost is that drones or the use of drones becomes the strategy itself or is perceived to be the strategy. And so putting that in sort of a more relational context, I think, is incredibly important, whether you're talking about the guy in Pennsylvania or you're talking about, you know, Osama bin Laden or someone in Yemen that we don't know.
Yeah, I called my book The Drone Memos, which is misleading, right? It's not about drones, but I do have at the beginning.
But it's sexy.
It's sexy, exactly, right? But there is an epigram at the beginning from John Rizzo, who's the former acting general counsel for the CIA. And he did this amazing interview with Tara McKelvey, who was at the time a reporter for Newsweek, which I think he, for some reason, thought the interview was off the record, and it was not off the record. And he ended up being very candid about the drone campaign. And at one point, Tara says to John Rizzo, she starts to ask him a question about drones, and he says, "Why are you seeing drones? You know, it could as easily be a bullet to your head." And you know, there's something.
Exactly right.
You know, the drone. It is like, in a sense, you know, I called my book The Drone Memos because everybody identifies drones with this, you know, practice of targeted killing. But drones are a kind of abstract, you know, an abstract concept in a way. You know, they hover 10,000 feet above us, in, you know, metaphorically as well as, you know, physically. But a bullet to your head—that's a very concrete thing, right? And so I thought it was a useful phrase that Rizzo gave us in a surprisingly and uncharacteristically honest phrase about this power that they're actually claiming. You may remember this Russian assassination of Alexander Litvinenko, I think I have his name right, in London. They poisoned his tea or his sushi or something, right? You know, the problem with naming a book The Drone Memos is it gives people the impression that it's about drones, when actually the Alexander Litvinenko thing is, you know, pretty close to what we're talking about.
You know, although I'm the one that brought up this critique, but now I'm going to defend the title of your book and subvert my own critique, because all this is true, right? It doesn't even have to be a bolt to the head. It could be one caveman hitting another caveman on the head with a rock. It's can you kill or not? Sometimes you can, sometimes you can't, as a matter of law. But before armed drones, you know, we didn't really have them until in any sizable number until 2008, 2009. Mm-hmm. Didn't have them at all before 2001 or 2. We still had the ability to send fighter jets over to blow things up with pilots in them. We still had the ability to shoot cruise missiles from offshore ships that would blow something up an hour and a half later. But it was a lot harder. There were pragmatic obstacles to blowing things up in hard to penetrate areas like the mountains of Pakistan or the desert of Yemen, where we didn't have people on the ground who really knew who was in this house. Or if we fired something because someone's there, by the time the missile got there, they may have left and someone else showed up. Or if our aircraft is overhead and gets shot down, now we've got either a dead American or a captured American. Huge burdens and obstacles to doing it very often. Because drones are cheap, relatively speaking, if one gets shot down, the pilot is in Las Vegas just goes home to dinner anyway, because they can hover and they can shoot a missile and right away something blows up, or if someone drives up, they can try to abort up to a certain point. It's just so much easier than it ever was before to pull the trigger. And that means that we're going to be pulling the trigger a lot more often. And so even though cavemen have always been able to hit other cavemen on the head with rocks, that sort of pragmatic burden to doing it very often acted, I think, as sort of a shadow gloss on the law. It wasn't, whatever this was about when you could kill versus when something is imminent or not, and whether it was a true battlefield or not, there was also going to be when it wasn't a true battlefield, when you didn't have troops on the ground. It just was something that was going to happen in exceptional circumstances only. The drone has enabled this to become something that happens routinely. And that's why these issues are so much more fraught now than they ever were.
And in sharper focus. I want to, before I open it up to questions, I have, if we would have done this event a month ago, I wouldn't have these two questions. But I have these two questions now. I want to start with, if you were sitting in the White House right now, and you were thinking about your legacy, and you were preparing to leave office, what would be sort of the greatest concern that you would have regarding the transfer of the U.S. drone program to the Trump administration?
I know some of the lawyers who went into the Obama administration, and they were, you know, human rights advocates before. They were real civil libertarians. You know, I looked at many of them as mentors and heroes, and I still have a lot of admiration for them. That said, I think that they were far too successful, and they must be thinking to themselves, I wish we had not been so successful at convincing the courts to stay out of this, at convincing Americans that we could be relied on to draw our own lines. I'm sure that some of them must be regretting their successes. I think there are still things they can do. There are things at the margins. You know, there's information they can release. By releasing information, you provoke a public debate. Maybe the public debate acts as a kind of check on the next administration. Maybe you create a baseline that the next administration feels obliged to, or at least there's a kind of stickiness to the transparency that you have, the transparency precedent you've set. And so it becomes harder for the next administration to back away from that precedent. So maybe there are things, at the margins that the administration could do. The sad truth, I think, is that it's too late for, we're not going to get legislation at this point constraining the drone campaign. We're not going to get, we're not going to get a court to step in over the next 3 months and say, you know what, when you carry out a strike outside an actual battlefield, you need to tell somebody why you're doing it. It's not going to happen now. I could conceive of, it's possible to imagine that under the next administration, the courts will be more skeptical, that the courts will ask more questions, be less willing to extend the kind of deference that they were willing to extend to the Obama administration. I hope that happens, but I don't see the possibility for dramatic reforms over the next 3 months.
I think that there is among the Obama team, current and former, because people have come in and out over the last 8 years, at this point a great fear that their record in their eyes will be misunderstood by people like me when I write articles saying, look at all these precedents Obama has set that will be available to Trump. Because they've been so sort of made a fetish out of identifying self-imposed constraints, like the 2013 playbook for drone strikes away from hot battlefields and so forth. And they think that legitimized a tool that they think, in fact, is very important to national security, that there really are people out there trying to kill us all the time, and sometimes this is the only available tool to do something about it, and worrying too much about it. The notion of that, is wrong because, in fact, this is legitimate, but these constraints help make it legitimate and help make it sure that it's not some kind of unconstrained, willy-nilly, irresponsible use of a power that is necessary in the world we unfortunately live in. And I think that they're afraid that Trump's going to come in and throw out all these constraints and use something that they used this much, but because they used it this much, people will say if it was legitimate, it's legitimate, right? The legitimacy doesn't turn on volume, and they will be remembered as having entrenched and normalized the excesses that they themselves didn't participate in, but did not shut the door on either, because they thought they were going to be handing the reins to Hillary Clinton and not Donald Trump. And that may in fact be exactly what happens. But I think that they're confronting that right now and feeling very badly about the prospect of that.
Do you think, just to follow, do you think there will see an expansion of the drone program under President-elect Trump? Or do you think there'll be a different use of the drone, of U.S. drones and the assets that we have? I mean, I don't know. I mean, I ask this question all the time. And I think we have so little information to go on. Bombing, I think I heard the euphemism today, the stuffing out of ISIS and going after terrorists and their families lends itself very well to how drones have been used. That's pretty much the entirety of the Trump statements in the campaign about sort of use of force. I'm not sure what more we can say.
Yeah, I mean, wanted to expand the drone campaign, you could expand it to more countries. It's 7 countries now. It could be 8 or 9, right? You could get rid of the PPG, the 2013 constraints, and
executive orders.
Right. And you could get rid of the transparency, right? The transparency commitment. So there are definitely ways you could do it if you wanted to. But I think you're right. We haven't heard anything specific from the new administration. For me, it's hard to separate just to go back to what Charlie was saying earlier about, and he was characterizing the administration's arguments about the precedent it has or hasn't set. Mm-hmm. For me, it's hard to separate the use of the power from the power that was claimed, right? So the administration made the argument, well, Anwar al-Awlaki is a uniquely serious threat, right? And that's part of their justification for having done what they did. But even if you accept that he's a uniquely serious threat, the claim they made was that the executive branch can declare a U.S. citizen to be a legitimate target for lethal force, can carry out the targeted killing, and then withhold information, all information about the basis for the strike. Now, it's true they actually did release some information in dribs and drabs, which we couldn't really test, because it was selectively disclosed. But to the extent they released the information, it was a matter of discretion, not a matter of, not from their perspective, not a matter of law, not a legal requirement. To me, it's hard to separate, so there's the application to Anwar al-Awlaki, and then there's the claim that they made. Those two are very closely intertwined, and I know that at the time they made the claim, they must have had in their heads, well, what's going to happen when somebody else, asserts this power? And yet they still made that claim. So I am not very sympathetic to this argument that, we adopted all these, constraints on the program and we shouldn't be held responsible for the way it's used, 4 years or 8 years from now. They should have known that, at some point these powers would be used in that way. I think that President Obama was a great president in many different ways. And I don't like, right now, especially when we're, facing an administration that is likely to be far worse on human rights issues and civil liberties issues, I don't like, saying that they created these powers that are going to be abused in this way. But they did. And I think that, Democrats should take responsibility for having invested President Obama with these powers, and I think that Americans more generally should think about how we came to invest all of this power in the presidency because we trusted the person who happened to be occupying that office at that particular moment. It was a crazy thing to do, and I think it would be a lost opportunity if we didn't learn from that mistake.
And before I open it to questions,
I just one thing you said jumped out at me that just as a to throw it on the table, like what they must have had in their head when they were thinking about killing Aleki, someday someone else will use this for some other purpose, right? I think what they had in their head primarily was this guy almost killed 300 people over Detroit on Christmas and did a bunch of other stuff that fortunately didn't happen. And what's going to happen when one of those plots succeeds and it comes to light that we could have taken him out and chose not to?
That all sounds right to me. But why then make the argument to the court later that we shouldn't be required to present evidence. Why not present the evidence?
Right. Well, I mean, so where we've been diagrammed perfectly is I think they were outrageously opaque about that, at least after the fact.
Yeah.
And, you know, the most information they ever put out was in the sentencing memorandum for the guy with the underwear bomb who tried to blow up that plane on Christmas in 2009, Abdulmutallab. And it contained what purported to be, because we didn't see the transcripts of the tapes, a summary of what he had told the FBI when he was spilling his guts to the FBI, notwithstanding the false claim politically that he wasn't talking because he should have been sent to Gitmo. That's a whole other issue. And so he describes in great detail, you know, going to Yemen, trying to find Alec Yeeks, he'd heard his sermons, and eventually getting into a house with him and being groomed for a martyrdom mission and meeting up with other AQAP people who design bombs and so forth and being instructed about how to go out on this mission. So that was a huge part of their, that interrogation session in January of 2010 was a huge part of their evidence against him. Presumably they also had some kind of NSA intercepts or something or another. But there's no reason why they, so you can understand why they wouldn't want to put out NSA intercepts, or if they had some kind of human informant in AQAP who was telling them things, you can understand why they wouldn't want to talk about that. I don't understand why they didn't long before, and still to this day are resisting putting out the transcripts of that interrogation session of this guy who's been convicted and is in Florence.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with all of that. I don't think it would be enough to put that out into the public. I think that the biggest mistake they made in you know, from a kind of civil liberties perspective here, the biggest mistake they made in the 6 or 7 years of the drone campaign was arguing that the question whether an American was a lawful target was a political question committed to Congress and the president. The courts had no role to play in evaluating whether the killing of an American was lawful or not. I think that, you know, that's the claim, which was successful in the district court, right?
Twice over, right.
So
like Steve Vladek has argued that they were right to do that before the strike,
right,
but wrong to do it after the strike,
that's right.
when the tension had disappeared.
Yeah, which I think that's a reasonable position, you know, Steve's position.
So I want to make sure that we have time for questions. We have a mic that I will encourage you to use, but to hold very straight so it doesn't. So we'll start here and then to the front. Start here, Victor.
Start here?
Yeah.
Hi, Kevin Meister, currently, is that working?
We'll repeat the question.
Yeah, go ahead. If you just want to ask it, we can repeat it.
Kevin Meister, currently an intern at Human Rights First. Thank you for this interesting panel discussion. I had you kind of stole my last question, Mistel. Because I wanted to see if you had any insights on how Trump is gonna go forward with the drone program, if you have any inside information on that. And as you were talking, I was sent an article from the Washington Post reporting that General Mattis has been chosen for Secretary of Defense. So do you know if he's expressed any observations on the drone program? And second, since you spoke about how all these powers have been vested in the president, do you think that this is also due to the fact that Congress has not stepped up to pass legislation on a new AUMF to authorize the force and to limit the use of the drone program? Thank you.
There's a lot of questions there.
Yeah. The one question was, what is Trump planning in sort of greater detail? Is he planning anything? As far as, you know, I don't have a great window into the Trump transition, but I do know some people who are working on it. And I have asked, at this time 8 years ago, there was a cabal of lawyers with the Obama transition who were whirring away writing executive orders that were going to be issued in the first couple days about transparency and famously closing Gitmo and banning CIA prisons and so forth. And I was like, is there some equivalent who's worrying away saying we're going to rescind the PPG and we're going to do this and this? And if there is, it's such a disorganized and poorly communicative group that the people at least that I know are unaware of it. There seems to be groups that are focused on particular themes like Obamacare and immigration, but in terms of like a general national security, legal policy vetting, at this point I have not found evidence that anyone is yet in any kind of organized way thinking about it. Doesn't mean that they won't get to it tomorrow. We're still some ways off from January 20th. I'm not aware of anything Mattis has said publicly, but
I don't know.
So the second part was General Mattis apparently was, while we've been here, breaking news, has been appointed Secretary of Defense, I think is what you said?
Nominated.
And so the question was whether or not there's any insight on his views of the drone program, and I am not aware.
I don't know them, yeah.
So it'll be interesting.
Part of the question was about the AUMF, right? Mm. About whether part of the problem here has been Congress's unwillingness to legislate, to pass a new authorization for use of military force.
That's not the critique you make, right?
I wouldn't be, you know, that's not the critique, but beyond that, I think that my impression, this may be from some of your stories, Charlie, is that President Obama, one of the reasons he's been reluctant to go to Congress seeking a new AOMF is that he worried, I think quite justifiably, that Congress would give him more power than he needed. And he was worried in this particular instance about the way that power might be used by the next president. So it's hard to know, like, you know, in the abstract, yes, I think it would be better if Congress were engaged and, you know, were actually thinking about cabining this power in the way, but in some way. But given the reality of, you know, the Congress we have right now, I don't know what that debate would look like, and I don't know that the result would be one that was friendly to human rights and, you know, yeah.
In point of fact, Obama did ask for an AUMF to go after the Islamic State, and it couldn't pass Congress because Obama wanted too many limits on it.
Yeah.
And Congress was only willing to pass one that was unlimited, and so then the whole thing just sort of collapsed. So that is an instance where the critique you make of them, that they're not thinking about this, has an exception.
That's right.
Let's have this gentleman here in the green sweater and say, maybe it's working now. Yeah.
It's working now. I really appreciate the Stinson Center for doing this and for the discussion. One question would be, how many U.S. citizens have been assassinated by the drone program? And a group of us will be doing a protest, anti-drone protest at the inauguration. If you have any advice in that regard, please share it.
Well, Charlie can speak to the second part.
Advice?
On the first one, you know, the only U.S. citizen who's been targeted, as far as we know, is Anwar al-Awlaki, who was killed in 2011. Now, there's, I think, seven other U.S. citizens. Is it seven or six?
So there's Samir Khan, also in the same strike. There's Abdullah Rahman.
There was
the guy, like, a month after that we only found about years later, who was killed. And then there was the doctor who was killed by mistake, the hostage. That's five.
Weinstein,
yeah.
Yeah.
But that was in India. Yeah, that was not a that was an accident.
But he was still
killed by a U.S. drone strike, yeah.
Because we've been debating this, you know, because we want to have accurate information we put out, and it seems to be difficult to find that.
That information is out there. I can give it to you after the panel. One thing that you should recognize is that the vast majority of people who are killed in drone strikes are not American citizens, right? They're non-citizens. And one sort of ambivalence I have about the litigation that we brought at the ACLU is that we brought litigation on behalf of U.S. citizens or survivors of U.S. citizen U.S. citizens who've been killed in drone strikes. We did that in part because the claim to the protection of the Fifth Amendment is much stronger for U.S. citizens than it is for anyone else. And so, you know, the litigation had, you know, to the extent it had any traction at all, is because there were U.S. citizens involved. And then, you know, this often happens, is that the litigation drives the public debate, at least, you know, or moves the public debate, or focuses the public debate, and so the public debate came to focus probably more than it should have on the killing of American citizens, when in fact, you know, the vast majority of people who are killed in these strikes are not American citizens, and international law does distinguish between, you know, the same protections that apply to Americans apply to everybody else. The relevant question is, you know, are you in a law of war framework or in a human rights framework? It doesn't have to do with citizenship. It has to do with whether there's an armed conflict or not and the scope of the armed conflict. Those are the relevant questions. Even American law, you know, it's clearer that U.S. citizens have a claim to protection under the Fifth Amendment, but there's an argument that a non-citizen who is killed by a U.S. drone strike away from a conventional battlefield ought to be able to come into an American court and challenge the lawfulness of the strike. So I kind of regret, I mean, I'm glad we brought the litigation. I think on the whole, it had the effect of provoking a public debate that would otherwise have been a relatively shallow one. It forced the government to release some information, although not as much as we hoped it would. But I do regret that it distorted the debate in this one way, that it made it seem like the real question here was the lawfulness of killing an American. And you know, from a particular constitutional perspective, that is a uniquely interesting question, but in the grand scheme of things, that's sort of the tail wagging the dog.
This gentleman here in the front.
Yeah, Kenmore, Eckhart, World Docs. In the documents you've seen, is there any discussion amongst those involved in our targeted killing campaign about the possibility of the victims of our targeted killings responding in kind? In other words, sending a lone assassin to this country to perform a lone targeted killing of their own? And if not, why not? It seems like such a simple operation compared to sending 19 lapdance-loving Muslims to this country who successfully...
You know, I imagine that if ISIS could send somebody here to carry the targeted killing, they would.
How could they not? They've got foreign.
Thousands
of foreign soldiers.
The debate you do see in the documents is about the larger effectiveness of this strategy. Like, it is. There are a lot of officials who think that, you know, Charlie, again, sort of channeling some of the people that he's spoken to, said that, you know, this is a tactical necessity, that drone strikes, you know, if you're worried about somebody bombing a plane tomorrow, a drone strike is, it's a very useful tool to have, and you can find officials all over the place who will say that. It's harder to find officials who will say that this campaign has been a strategic success. You know, at the very least, you know, they admit that it's impossible to know, because for every drone strike you make that eliminates one supposed enemy, you generate other enemies, you know. And I think that there is a growing recognition that, Dennis Blair, who was the president's counterterrorism advisor very early on in Obama's counterterrorism advisor in his first term, said, the national security, the tactical advantages are obvious right away, but the strategic costs become visible only much later. And I quote a bunch of other people, equally senior, who say things like that. That's the debate you see in not so much the documents, but in some of their public statements about
just to amplify that, before I came over here this afternoon, I was talking to Scott Shane, my colleague who works a lot in this area and wrote the book about Aleki. Just about, well, what should I say when Jameel starts wailing away and I have to sit there and respond without being somehow an apologist or whatever. And he brought up this pattern. So it's not just Blair, right? There's also McChrystal said things like this, and I think Cartwright at various times. Mm-hmm. And he reminded me that at the end of his
Michael
book,
Flynn.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
At the end of his book on Aleki, which is also about drones, he records a passage where he's talking to Ben Rhodes, sort of high-ranking NSC official in Obama's White House, and brings up, look at all these formers who are at the very top of this and now seem very ambivalent at best about whether this is actually an effective thing. And Rhodes responds to him it's true that you see this constellation of these guys saying this, but notably they're all saying it when they're out of government and not when they're in government. Mm-hmm. And he says, maybe they should have said it when they were in government. On the other hand, maybe something about not being responsible anymore for the thing that blows up tomorrow makes it, you know, obscures.
I would put it slightly differently. I mean, I think that that's, you know, that there's something there, but it's not just not being responsible. It's when they're in government, they're responsible for what happens tomorrow, but they're not responsible. They don't think of themselves, they don't worry about what happens 4 years from now. That's Trump's problem. That's somebody else's problem, right? So it's not, I mean, the way you put it makes it seem like, you know, we should listen to the people when they're in government because that's when they have the burden on their shoulders. But it's precisely because, yeah, I mean, I think it's precisely because they have this burden on their shoulders that they might not be the right people to talk to about the strategic value of the campaign. Tactics are, you know, they have a very high discount rate, right? They care about, you know, they care about what happens tomorrow. They don't care about what happens, not care is too strong a word, but, you know, they don't feel responsible in the same way.
The priority is the image crisis. Yeah.
But when, and I think that might actually be a good place to wrap up, because I think clearly we have our work cut out for us in the next administration and on this issue and many others. But I think, you know, when we look at what you just said, Jameel, that we that they're looking at, you know, a strategic or a tactical success today and not necessarily the strategic long-term impact, we sort of should demand that from our leaders. If they're claiming that they've increased the use of this technology because of all the reasons that Charlie mentioned, you know, that it can loiter, that it can stay up there a long time, it's very precise, et cetera. If we've decided that this is a tool that is really valuable, then we should know if it's accomplishing the strategic goals that we would like it to, because there somebody must be keeping, I truly believe somebody is keeping track somewhere of the result of the strike, the impact of the strike, what the aftermath of the strike was, what then happened in that community because of the strike later on, so that we can somehow, we need to understand the metric that's being used to decide, yes, this is a valuable tool. And until we have that, we're gonna see the same pattern sort of repeating as, you know, that becomes a focus on the technology rather than sort of this larger strategic issue of targeted killings. And so I'd like to see sort of our next conversation, because I think this conversation will continue, sort of look to unpack some of this more robustly. And I think, unfortunately, we're going to have a lot of opportunity to do that in the next 4 years and beyond. So I do want to thank both of you for what to me has been a really fascinating conversation. I could selfishly sit here for a much longer time. I do want to let folks know that we will be having a reception, so that we'll give you an opportunity to engage with Jameel and Charlie a bit longer. But for them, more importantly, we will be selling copies of their books here in about 2 minutes. So if you would like a copy, you may purchase one. They are at discounted prices. We are not making a profit off of these. These are just a discount. You can get them signed, and please do stay for food and beverages. And join me in thanking Charlie and Jameel for a really fascinating conversation.